Well, it's nice to be talking to you again today, and I'm recording in the kitchen today, so there might be a little bit of an echo in my voice, so don't adjust your set, as they say. Well, we're continuing through Romans, and my plan is that we get to the end of Romans 8 by the end of this week. And then we have Holy Week next week, where we'll do something different leading up to Easter. And then after Easter, I'll take a week off just to give myself a little bit of break, and then we'll get going with a new series. That's not to say that the rest of Romans is not important. Well, it's very important. But I think that having covered the first 8 chapters in some fashion, it gives you the core essence, I think, of our gospel foundations. And that's what Paul was trying to do, helping the people in Rome that he'd never met to understand what they believed. In the midst of that community, there were Christians who were both Jew and Gentile backgrounds. And that's, of course, part of the background of some of the emphases that he has. He will then come to 9, 10, and 11 chapters, that is, where he deals with the place of Israel and God's people there. And that's a very crucial part. And God has a place for his people, a very special place for his first called people, the Israelites. And then 12 to the end of the chapter deals with outworking practical implications, beginning with those words, therefore. In other words, again, as a consequence of all these things that I have been sharing with you, what does that mean in everyday life practically? Now, we could return to those at a later date if you wish, but I would encourage you to read through the rest of the book at a slow and steady pace. And I think building on what we've been doing, I hope it will make more sense to you. And so today we want to think about these two verses, verses 31 and 32. And they say, what then shall we say in response to these things? These things, that is, not just what he's said in the previous few verses of this chapter, but I think all of these things, because when he refers to things, he's writing a letter from beginning to end. And he answers that, if God is for us, who is against us? And then he who did not spare even his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Adding up the double line. I'm sure you've sometimes heard of that phrase, like, give me the double line. And it's a kind of a way of saying, like, when you add everything up, what do we get? Where are we at? What's the end result of this? It usually has to do with measurements, finances, or something like that. But in this case, Paul's saying, now, when you add all of this up in response to these things, when you draw the double line under all that we've already learned, what does it mean? And this is what it means. And he will say that in a few verses from here to the end of the chapter. And these are very, very important. Now, I'm sure we've already learned a number of the things that it means. We know for sure lots of things. But now this kind of condenses it. And then in a style that would be good of any teacher, he brings us back to summarize some of those things. So we're going to think about just the couple that are to be found here. And in fact, they're so incredible that each one of them really needs to be thought about. If God is for us, who is against us? Now, the word if could also be since. Sometimes that word is translated in that way. Since God is for us, who is against us? You know, there are times whenever you look around your team and you say, well, I'm so glad I've got that person on my team or that person on my team, or some advantage, you know that you've got a pretty good chance of success. But when we come to think about God is for us, meaning if we have ultimately everything, the reality of God, his eternal nature, everything is for us. And even thinking about that word for is a heavy word as well. If you say, God is for me, yes, he is for you. I know there are times in your life when you think, God can't be very happy with me today, but God is for you. He's always for you because his son was the one who allowed himself to be, as it were, God was against his son in judgment on that cross. And so this really is a wonderful encouragement to us, so that we may well have doubts and anxieties and concerns and even the enemy of our souls doggedly at our heels. But it's okay. We never need to doubt. God's protecting care and his love and his promises around us. And that's not something necessarily that I can easily illustrate. That's something that I just have to embrace. When I embrace this truth, the impact of that is it kind of bleeds out into my whole life in such a way that it impacts every part of my being. But then go on to the second of these two verses. He who did not spare even his own son, but gave him up for us all, and that all most likely there includes for Jew and Gentile, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? As I was thinking about that sense, you know, who did not even give up his own son, even his own son, I was thinking then, it reminds us of Genesis 22 and 12, where Abraham and Isaac go up that mountain, and Isaac is going to be offered on the altar. And then God intervenes, and he rescues Isaac from that moment. And then the words to Abraham are, "You have not withheld your son." That points forward to this time when the Lord sends his son, gives his son, and then gives him up, which is slightly more than just give. The giving up infers the offering up and sacrifice. But as I read this and I wrote it out on my page, he did not spare even his own son. I underlined that word even a number of times because it just reminds me how much God has done. And it makes us think much more clearly, and it really needs for us to pause on that. Whatever it must be for God to do this calls us to a place where we may seldom be, to think about the cost, to think about the price, to think about the incredible gift, the willingness. Now, when we put this in human terms and think about giving away a part of ourselves, giving away a child, we can't even go there. We find it so hard to, I wouldn't even allow myself to think in those terms. But yet that is what God has done. And in comparison to the so many things that occupy our minds, our energies, our dreams, our efforts, surely nothing can come close to this if it's understood even a little. The sense of value that we must place upon this. This is one of the reasons why doing this in a slow way really helps us to take a good look again at this truth. And it should be sufficient, surely, to move us in lots of ways. Well, when I think about just how much God has done, then surely it should move me to trust the word and the promise of the one who acts in this way. It should also move me to worship. For who has done anything as remarkable as this for me or for you or for I? The one who has loved and the one who has died, can there really be anything greater? I know we talk about these things, we sing about them, we read them, but do we think about them as we do that so that they actually get under our skin, as it were, and really impact us? And then not only do they move us to trust and to worship, but I think they should also move us to joyfully serve. You see, it's one thing to serve duty, as it were, by duty, but when we realize the wonderful love of our Father, the wonderful kindness of our Savior, surely it changes the very way in which we do things. We no longer serve, well, I must. We think, no, that this truth, it kind of unlocks, as it were, a great gate of willingness from our hearts. We run to do that so that we're glad to serve the purposes that have been won through the love of Jesus. I know that these are not little stories that people, you know, like to hear a little story and it keeps you, it's interesting and entertaining. But, you know, this is something so much more important. This is the story of all stories. This is the story that makes every other story seem rather pale by comparison. This is the one story in the universe that makes the universe make sense. Now, do I understand all of the detail in this? What those phrase, that phrase, he did not spare even his own son. Shall I ever understand that? what it means for God, the perfect, loving Father, eternal, powerful, omnipotent, to give up his son? I don't think I will. I think that part of my task for life and for eternity is to try to understand it and to enjoy the blessing that comes from the bit I do. So I pray that you will even take a little bit of time today just to thank the Lord for this. Thank him. Be still in his presence and just thank him. And let the Holy Spirit impress upon you this truth and let it impact as so he chooses.